Tonight we will be reading from Luke 2, verses 1 through 20. I invite you to grab a copy of the scriptures or follow along on the screen as I read. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinus was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. Thank you. Will you join me in prayer? Dear Lord, thank you so much for the gift you have given us in Christ's birth, Lord. I'm so honored to be here with my church family tonight to listen to Pastor Mike talk to us more about the scripture that we just read. And I pray that all of us would be just like Mary and ponder these truths in our heart. And I ask this in your name. Amen.
Well, good evening and Merry Christmas. My name is Mike Lee, and I get to be the pastor here at Valley Life North Mountain. I am so glad that you have joined us for Christmas Eve service. And if I've never met you, I would sure like to do that. Probably the best way for us to do that, since we're online tonight, is for you to just send me an email. You can reach me at mike@valleylife.church. I'd love to get to know your name and know that you were here with us tonight, and maybe we can chat a little bit. So we have spent the last month as a church, really the month of December, in our Christmas series that we simply called Christmas at Valley Life. And so over the last three Sundays, we've really looked at some different aspects of Christmas. It's really been sort of an Advent series, and so we looked at Christmas hope, we talked about Christmas peace, and then last Sunday we talked about Christmas joy, and tonight we get to talk about Christmas love. So for the last couple of years, we have started every single Christmas Eve service at this church the exact same way. We've asked Ashley Parks, our kids ministry director, to get up and simply read us the Christmas story. And so she did that just a little bit ago. She read through Luke chapter 2. And I have found that no matter how many times I hear that story, and no matter how many times we preach through that story, it just never gets old. I mean, when you think about the story itself, it has everything that you might want in a really good story. It has a royal decree from Caesar. It has a young betrothed couple traveling to Bethlehem together. It has shepherds watching their flock by night, and then angels bringing good news of great joy for all the people. And most importantly, above all things, it has a baby. But what kind of story is this, really? You see, as we know, every story has a different genre. There might be an action story like the Avengers, or maybe an adventure story like Indiana Jones, or even a historical story like Tombstone, or sometimes we like to watch comedy stories like the movie Elf. So you might ask yourself, well, what kind of story is the Christmas story? What kind of story is this? And the thing that I want you to know tonight is that the Christmas story, above all things, is a love story. You see, the events of this story and the birth of Jesus is first and foremost a love story. And if you find yourself questioning that, it is probably because we have been distorted as to what a love story looks like. We think a love story is what we see in movies and in TV shows. You know those kind of shows, the TV show or the movie where the guy is searching for the love of his life. And by the end of the movie, he realizes that the one true love that he has is also his best friend since grade school. And they finally realize that in each other and they get married and it's fantastic. Or we think a love story is like we see on TV shows where season after season, the two main characters we all know should be together just can't seem to figure it out. They just can't get the timing worked out. And finally, right around the series finale, they finally realize that they were meant for each other and they fall in love. Or we think of a love story as those movies where a man and a woman get married very young and they live a long, happy life. And at the end of one of their lives, the wife passes away and the husband dies just a couple of days later because he just can't stand to be without his wife. And those stories are fun. But they are not love stories like this one tonight. You see, because love is not some romantic notion or attraction. You've probably heard me say this before. You've heard this quote, and I will probably quote it again in the future. The best definition of love I've ever heard comes from my friend Brian Bowman, who says, love is this. Love is sacrifice, nothing less, and maybe nothing more. And if you define love as sacrifice, you could see that this Christmas story is a chapter of the greatest love story ever told. You see, the big picture story between God and man goes like this. God made the world and it was perfect. And it was beautiful and everything worked right. But then man sinned and broke it. And now that it's broken, nothing works right in the world. And we see evidence of that every day. But that one of the worst parts of that brokenness is that it actually leads to a separation between God and man. But God loved us so very much that he would not leave us in that separated state. And so he sent Jesus on a rescue mission to save us. And of course, while Jesus was here, he lived the perfect life that you and I never could. He died the horrific death that you and I deserved, and he defeated that death so that anyone who would believe in him could be saved. And the Christmas story is the pivotal chapter in that overall amazing love story. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." God loved us so very much that he sent Jesus down here to earth. Not just so that we could celebrate his birth once a year, not just so that we could marvel at the baby in the manger, but so that he could save us. And it is this story of how, in order to save us, Jesus had to leave that manger and grow up and eventually die on a cross as a sacrifice for our sin that we celebrate. John 15:12-13 says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends." Jesus literally laid down his life so that anyone who would believe in his life, death, and resurrection could be saved. And so tonight we celebrate that love has come into the world. And when we look at this familiar passage as a church, we will sing to Jesus because he came down as love. And so as we begin to unpack this story, I want you to know that the love of Christmas is found in the birth of Jesus. Ashley read this text just a moment ago, but I'll read it again to you. It says this in Luke chapter 2, verses 15 through 16. It says, "When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us.' And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger." So here is the baby lying in a manger, and everything we have looked at in this series is represented in baby Jesus. Jesus is the hope of Christmas. Jesus is the peace of Christmas. Jesus is the joy of Christmas, and of course, Jesus is the love of Christmas. the baby lying in the manger means that God loved us so much that he sent his one and only son. The baby lying in the manger means that Jesus loved us so much that he sacrificed the glory of heaven to come down to earth as a baby. The baby lying in a manger is a reminder that even though there was literally no room for him at the inn, there is room for Jesus in every heart who believes. This is the love story that made the prophecy come true. As Isaiah wrote in 7:14, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." And this sacrifice changes everything. And that is what we celebrate on Christmas. This week at work, as some of you know, I'm a co-vocational pastor, which means I pastor this church and I have another job. And this week at work, a man came to me and he said, "I don't know that I have anything to celebrate this year." I said, "Man, well, what's going on?" He said, "Well, between the fact that my brother has COVID and another friend of mine has COVID and my parents aren't doing well, everywhere I look is just awful and I've got nothing to celebrate." And I just looked at him and I said, "Man, I just want you to know that we can celebrate this Christmas for the very same reason that Christians have been celebrating Christmas for over 2,000 years. We can celebrate because the love of God has come down to sacrifice and save anyone who believes. The birth of Jesus means that we don't have to be separated from God anymore. The birth of Jesus means that even though the world is still dark and scary and broken, we can have hope and joy and peace because God loves us that much. When we look at the story, we see the love of God poured out for all who believe. And so what do we do with the love of Christmas? What do we do with this love? And tonight I want you to know that there are at least three things that we should do with the love of Christmas. And the first is simply this: the love of Christmas should be shared. The love of Christmas should be shared. Look at what the gospel says in verses 17 through 18. It says, "And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning the child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them." The shepherds showed up to see Jesus as shepherds, and they left that place as evangelists. Seriously, they showed up as people that tended sheep, and they left that place telling people about Jesus. This should be our reaction to encountering the love of Christmas. That guy in my office this week was serious. He really had no idea how to celebrate, and so I told him about Jesus. You probably have friends that don't know how to celebrate this year either. So tell them about Jesus. Tell them how God loved them so much that he sent Jesus down here to save them. Tell them how God loved you so much that he sent Jesus down here to save you. Tell them how you were once separated from God by the sin in your life, but then you believed and Jesus saved you. People have spent so much time over the last couple of weeks trying to find the perfect gift for all the people in your life. But if you have believed in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, if you have been saved, then you have the perfect gift to give to anyone. You can share Jesus with everyone, knowing that Jesus is faithful and able to save anyone. And so if you have experienced the love of Christmas, you should share it with others in your life. But you should also treasure it yourself. Sometimes we get so busy sharing the good news of Jesus that we forget to treasure it up ourselves. Sometimes we get really intentional about the mission of going out and telling people about Jesus, and we forget to, just for a moment, just at different times in our life, to treasure it for ourselves. And so I want you to know that the love of Christmas is worth treasuring in your heart. It's worth treasuring it in your heart. Luke 2:19 says, "But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart." I like to imagine that night. When I read this story, I like to imagine that night, and it seems like there was so many moving parts. when we think about this story that Ashley read, there's just so many moving parts. I imagine the night being very, 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 very frantic. I imagine Joseph frantically looking for a place for Mary to have this baby and there being no room available. I imagine Joseph trying to figure out where they should go. And I imagine him finding a space in this small manger and thinking to himself, this is probably the best I can do. I imagine that he was a frantic, expectant father trying to figure out the best thing to do for his family. I imagine shepherds having shocking encounters with angels. I imagine they were just doing whatever they would normally do. They're just tending sheep, doing what they're supposed to do, and an angel shows up. And before long, an angel choir shows up and starts singing. I imagine all these moving parts. It must have seemed very chaotic. And I imagine the angels singing and praising God. And then I imagine the shepherds running to see the baby, literally running on their way to Bethlehem. And I imagine the scene at the nativity, and I wonder about all that's going on there. I imagine so much movement, like so many moving parts. And then I imagine Mary. I imagine Mary, and I look at this verse, and I imagine Mary treasuring up these things in her heart. I imagine a calm Mary in spite of all the chaos. It makes me think of the night that my daughter Courtney was born. Courtney's birth story is certainly one of chaos, and some of you have heard it before, and I won't share it all tonight, but just some highlights. There was a period of preeclampsia. There was an emergency C-section. There was actually almost a fist fight between an OBGYN and an anesthesiologist about whether or not my wife was ready to deliver the baby. It was followed eventually by multiple hospital stays, and in the middle of all that, there was a moment where between the time that Courtney was pulled out from the C-section birth and when she was rushed off to the ICU, there was a moment that we were fortunate enough to get a picture of. There's this picture, this calm moment where the doctor holds Courtney up to Penny's mouth and Penny is able to kiss the new baby. And in that moment, it's like all the chaos stopped. It was this calm and peaceful moment that both Penny and I have treasured in our hearts ever since. And I imagine Mary like that on Christmas night. I imagine the chaos all around her, but I imagine her treasuring these things up in her heart. And I know that you may have chaos in your life right now too. Maybe you have chaos because of everything going on in the world. Maybe you have chaos because of COVID-19 or the financial implications of this. Maybe you have chaos for a million different reasons that have nothing to do with the pandemic. Or maybe you just have Christmas chaos. Maybe you have somewhere else you have to be tonight after the service. Maybe you have company coming over and you're playing this sermon in the background as you're trying to get everything ready and get it just right. Maybe you still have presents to wrap tonight. Maybe tomorrow will be chaotic for you. Maybe you have a big family or multiple families or so many things that you have to do. Some of you are just in the middle of a chaotic season. But in spite of all of the chaos that is going on, I would invite you and I would remind you to take some time and simply treasure the love of Christmas in your heart. Treasure the love of Christmas in your heart, just like Mary did. Treasure a Savior born who is Christ the Lord. Treasure that Jesus has come to save you. Treasure the fact that God loved you so much that he sent Jesus for you. Treasure the fact that this beautiful birth story will lead to a horrific death sentence that will lead to an even more beautiful resurrection story. Treasure this in your heart. In the midst of everything going on tonight and tomorrow and the rest of this season, I would encourage you and I would invite you to treasure the love of Christmas. And finally, the love of Christmas is worthy of our praise. The love of Christmas is worthy of our praise. Luke 2, verse 20 says, "And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it has been told them." The shepherds had come to see the baby, having been told about him from an angel. They were there in the presence of Jesus and Mary and Joseph. They left and told others what they had seen, and they left glorifying and singing praises to Jesus. The response of the shepherds to experiencing the love of Christmas was to worship. What they did that night was worship. This is why we sing at the end of sermons at our church. When we encounter Jesus, either for the very first time or after a while of not remembering about him and all that he has done, we worship, we sing, we praise. In just a moment, you will have the opportunity to respond to the love of Christmas in worship. Justine and the band will lead you, and it is right and good for you to sing right where you're at. Maybe you really wish that tonight you could be in person, and I know that you want that, and I want that for you. But for a good reason, you've decided to watch this sermon online, and I want you to know tonight that it is right and good for you to sing wherever you are. That if you've encountered the love of Christmas, you can sing. Because worship is always an appropriate response when we encounter the love of Christmas. You know, the Christmas story is many things. It's a beautiful and glorious story. And it's a love story. It's the story of a God loving us so very much that he sent his one and only son into the world as a baby. It's the story of a baby being the Savior who would save all who believe, the Christ who had been promised, and the Lord who would rightly rule forever and ever. It is the story of an end to the separation between God and man for whoever would believe. It is the story of light coming into a dark world. And I want you to know tonight that wherever you are part of that story. In the same way that Mary and Joseph and the shepherds are part of the story, so are you. You, Megan and Brian and Easton and Hadley, there at your house tonight are part of this story. This is your story. You, Kim and Alex and Nate are part of this story. This is your story. You, Kevin and Warnisha and JT, you are part of this story. You, Christy and Bailey and Madison, this is a story that you are part of. And every single person that is watching this sermon or listening to this online, this is your story too. You see, God loved you so much that he sent his one and only son. And Jesus loved you so much that he willingly laid his life down for yours. So tonight, as we encounter the Christmas story again or for the very first time, I would say to you, Merry Christmas. Love has come, and his name is Jesus. And if you believe, you should share this love. And if you believe, you should treasure this love. And if you should believe, you should respond in worship to this love. And so, church, tonight, I only have one question for you. Can you believe? Can you believe? Let's pray. God, we thank you for sending your one and only Son into the world to save us. We thank you that Jesus loved us enough to sacrifice himself for us. Help us to share this love with others, treasure this love in our hearts, and to worship you. And if there are people watching this sermon who have never believed, give them faith to believe. It is in your name that we pray. Amen. So we've come to the end of this part of our night together. And I'm going to end this the way that I end every single sermon that I will ever preach, and that is with an invitation. And tonight, for you watching at home, I have three invitations for you. The first is this: I would invite you to believe. If you're watching this sermon, maybe you were just scrolling through on Facebook and you saw it and decided to sit in. Maybe a friend invited you. Maybe you've never been to church or ever heard the name Valley Life before, and you just heard the gospel. And if you've never believed, I want to invite you to believe. You can do that right now wherever you're at. You could simply admit that you are a sinner. You could believe in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, and you can confess that belief with your mouth. Scripture says that if we can believe these things in our heart and confess them with our mouth, then Jesus will save us. And I want you to know that wherever you are, Jesus can save you tonight. You can be part of this story. You can be the benefactor of this story. And the separation that exists between God and sinners will be no more for you. The other invitation that I have for you is to come back. I want to invite you to come back to our church. I would invite you to two different ways to do that. We meet in person every Sunday at 10 o'clock at Thunderbird High School. And you can look up that information right here on our page. And we also meet in online every Sunday morning at 10:30. And so I would invite you to come back. I would invite you to come and be part of this church. I would invite you to come and be part of a church that loves Jesus and loves people. And if you'd like some help to do that, again, you can just email me, mike@valleylife.church, and I would love to connect with you and get to know you. And my third invitation for you is to share the love of Jesus with somebody else. It's not too late to do that this season. You could send them a copy of this sermon. You could simply call them and tell them what Jesus has done for you. I would invite you to treasure up the gift of the love of Jesus in your heart, to take some time over the next couple of days and the days that follow to just treasure up what it means that God sent Jesus to save you. And finally, I would invite you to worship. Right there where you are, join Justine and the band and sing praises to Jesus. Merry Christmas, Valley Life. I am so blessed to be your pastor. It is of great joy to me. I love you, and I'll see you soon.
reaches to the skies, but there's no space between you and I. Wherever I go, can wait. Oh my soul, what a beautiful day.